great to be here, eventually. Ended up on a fishing boat this morning, as opposed to flying from Guernsey, so it was a bit stressful to get here, but I'm relaxed now, so that's great. First bad news, one bit of bad news. Unfortunately, the guys from Google absolutely stuck with flights. There's nothing you could do about it. They tried the best to get it, but they couldn't get it. But the good news is, they're still going to be part of the meeting. They're listening into us now, and they're going to do their presentations via Skype. So they'll answer questions, all the rest of it. So all of the content, the input, the questions that you would raise with one person is still online. Okay.
So they're online at the moment. They can see you and hear you through this camera at the moment.
They're waving at me, believe me. You'll see them all. It gets more and more complicated with the different presentations you've got, so bear with us, okay? So I'm just going to kick off. Bit of background, really. Obviously, this is really around digital marketing, social media, and developing your businesses. So just setting the scene a little bit first of all. Historical marketing, we've all used it, I'm sure. Some of us probably still do use a fair amount of it in different ways, different channels. Personally, I think we shouldn't dismiss or ignore any of these channels necessarily, because they all have value. Newspapers, yeah, people still do read advertising in newspapers, so again, you know, we shouldn't ignore it. But we also have to be aware, obviously, the number of newspapers is reducing all the time, so it is outdated perhaps. The number of cold letters that we get through the post is probably vastly reduced, but it used to be a really, really strong channel, didn't it? Used to be inundated with them. Radio advertising is still well used, and again it has its place, but perhaps a little bit old school sometimes. And it's really, what results do we get from radio, and can we measure them, and is it the best way of spending money and getting a return on investment? Yellow pages. Who still uses yellow pages? Yeah. Again, yellow pages, I think it has its place. The problem with yellow pages, if you miss the deadline, you've got to wait another year probably to get the advert on the paper version. And it might be fairly expensive. Okay. Another channel, telemarketing. Does anyone use telemarketing? No? Okay. Again, telemarketing was incredibly popular. And it still has its place. But again, that's moved. It used to be about 200 calls would get a meeting. They say the numbers are going more towards about 600 calls to get a meeting there. So it's a lot more difficult. So the point I'm trying to really make is, is don't be left behind. So we really need to think, what's the latest and the most up-to-date media channels that we need to be using. So this is what we're really going to be, these guys are going to be talking to you more about later. Anyone got any questions so far on what I've been saying or anything like that? Okay. Again, this is one of my favourite ones. This is the last two inaugurations of the Pope in 2005 and 2013. I think there is one there as well, actually. So it's just incredible, isn't it? How that's moved in such a short period of time in real time. So, I don't know why some of you are here today, and I don't know what you are hoping to get out of the two-hour presentation. So, maybe it's just your intrigue, maybe you're just here, you're hoping to learn a bit more, which is great. Maybe you need some help, maybe you need some support, and you don't know what to do next to develop your businesses. So, hopefully we can help you, give you some ideas today. Maybe you're looking for some help developing your own marketing plans to grow and develop your businesses. I hope some of you are, because that's what we're about. And maybe some of you are thinking, well, I know some of you are thinking about it because I've spoken to some of you on the phone. And one of the main things a lot of the people I spoke to was really you're looking for ways to generate new leads. Everyone looking for more leads? Yes? No? Yes? So obviously that's key for everybody, so that's really what a large amount of this is also about. Business help, obviously we provide a range of different programs, different types of products really to support business development and growth, so I'm just going to mention those very, very quickly. We do all sorts of programs really for any budget, going from online marketing, which is about £100 a month, to one-to-one coaching, and I coach businesses from all sizes, from literally man in a van type businesses, absolute startups, to quite considerable companies, and I charge them up to £2,000 a month for that. So there's something there for all types of businesses. What do you think is the hardest part of lead generation? This is where, is anyone brave enough to talk? So I hope so. Has anyone done any stuff around lead generation that's failed miserably? No? Okay, well I'll be brave.
Judge it really, isn't it?
Okay.
There haven't been any sales on it yet.
Okay.
I guess it's about the quality of the lead, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, an example I will give is, I mean, I tried telemarketing when I set up the business and I spent probably about £1,000 a month on it. I think I got one client after about 4 months. Was that my fault? I don't know. I mean, I did get some leads, but I didn't actually manage to convert any of them. Maybe they weren't the right type of people. I don't know. But it's really, the point is really, is trying to work out from your plan how you're going to generate the leads coming into your business that's actually going to work for you. And that's really the sort of thing that you work with your businesses to try and develop those kind of plans and to try and work out where to spend the money to get the best return on investment. At the end of the day, thank you for your input, it really is about measuring your return on investment on your spend, because wouldn't it be nice if you could spend £100 and get £200 back? We then wouldn't be worried about the budget, because we'd have a never-ending budget, would we? So that's where we're trying to get to. Maybe some of you, because of experiences, are in a frame of mind, actually, you can't do it because of bad experiences. So we get quite nervous about what to do next, because the last thing we want to do is waste money. So sometimes, a lot of businesses I speak to, they don't invest in marketing and sales because money's quite tight. So rather than spend any money, we don't do anything, which obviously isn't the way to go. So we have that fear of the unknown. What is the problem around this stuff? Well, maybe the problem is we need more leads because we want to grow the business, but we don't know what to do. So we have to work out really what our solution is. And it could be using these technical guys. That could be the answer, perhaps. It could be doing loads and loads of social media. It could be using LinkedIn. It could be developing a website. It could be doing pay-per-clicks. But it's having that integrated solution really to try and move your business on. And also finding ways of actually measuring the return on investment as well. The reason I'm telling you about this is really because, again, as I speak to lots and lots of business, the one thing I would say is you all share the same problems. It doesn't matter what type of business it is. Most small and medium-sized businesses really sort of fumble a bit in the dark a bit about this until they really get their own solution that starts working. So it's really trying to find a way of gearing that up. For those businesses that don't change quick enough, and I'm sure most of us can remember these, yeah? Jessup, to be fair, have actually come back into the marketplace, but they did fail. They didn't move fast enough, did they? They couldn't compete. And there's lots of others. So, really, don't get left behind. And it's where do you go from here? The thing is, I would say, is the more activity you do, you're naturally going to generate more leads. Well, it just is the way it works. Maybe you create your own luck. So, if what we're talking about today is of interest, it's really for you guys to then decide about what's the right road for you. And what speed do you want to change and what speed do you want to grow? And it's really about trying to think about where are you trying to get to, say in 3 years' time or 5 years' time. Because depending on your bigger objectives, really sort of leads you to what you need to be doing to develop your businesses. And that's really where defining your business plans is so important. Okay. before I move on, any questions from anybody or anything you want to discuss or share? Again, how's all this evolved over the last few years? This is the amount of activity now. It's quite incredible. 6 billion hours of YouTube watched monthly. 1.2 trillion hits there. Facebook, 1 billion Facebook visits a day. And enormous amounts of hits on the web. So clearly using social media is a really important channel for you to use. So what are you going to do with your business? Are you looking to make it bigger? There's a question really for you. If everyone put their hand up, is everyone using Facebook at the moment?
Yeah.
Yeah, so only put your hands down if the answer's no. Who's using LinkedIn? Okay, who's using YouTube? Okay, that's not bad. Who's got a fully developed marketing plan with an activity plan of how much posting and stuff you're going to do every month? Okay. A few of you. So, well done. But the rest of us, because I didn't put my hand up because I haven't got all of that in place probably either, that's really where we need to be going. We need to be in that position to be developing our business consistently. And you know, social media really is the first point of contact for most businesses now, let's be realistic. So the social media platforms that we're going to be talking about in a minute really are probably your most important channels, and you certainly need to have that really well worked out. Some tips perhaps for some of you, which might be helpful. Never buy fake likes. There's no point in having lots and lots of fake likes, because they're not going to be the people that are going to buy from you anyway.
What's the definition of a fake like?
Well, quite often, perhaps one way of thinking is, we put competitions out there as an example. We get lots and lots of likes, but we're not quantifying any of that. So do we really know if they're the right people that can actually buy from us anyway? I take it that a percentage of them will, but there's no focus to it. Yeah? So it's really making sure we're doing the right activity.
How does that differ from a competition where it essentially could also be a fake like, because you only like it so that you can be entered into the competition? That also would that not also be a fake competition?
It could well be. I'm not saying don't do it, but there might be better ways of doing it, because we're really trying to get people to actually follow our pages or our websites and people that we really think we could sell to. So we're really trying to identify real prospects as opposed to just thousands and thousands of people, because you know, if you're putting out boosting posts as an example on Facebook to absolutely everybody, one, it's costing you a great deal of money and it's not really targeted. Yeah, does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it's really trying to think, you know, who are our real prospects, who's likely to be our best customers, and again focusing our spend on that. Competitions and price, if we can do it in a focused way. And there's lots of analytics that we can do around that. They encourage conversation.
I was just going to say, what are the rules around competitions on Facebook now? Because it's quite strict, isn't it? Wasn't there a time when you weren't allowed to do competitions?
Yeah, there is, but there is some quite easy online platforms that just plug into Facebook, and all of the rules and regulations are built into that. One that I use with clients quite regularly is Easy Promos, and it's quite cheap. I think the last competition, we did a photo competition, cost us like $50 to run it for 2 weeks. I think we had something like 700 photo entries. So Easy Promos. That means you haven't got to learn the rules and regulations they're built in.
So the next thing is really around communication. You're doing all of this activity, but do you have a good CRM, customer relationship database, that you're using regularly? Because you're capturing lots of contacts, so then what are you doing with them? So again, it's really trying to find ways of continually and consistently putting that communication out there. A few more tips. It's really trying to segregate your potential clients as well, so again, you can be more focused in what you're trying to do. LinkedIn, again, we used to be able to segregate both our LinkedIn searches and the number of leads that we have into different groups, so then we can do more marketing to those specific groups and segments. And very much around promoting to the right audience. It's that whole thing, isn't it, really? If you're trying to sell a one-bedroom flat, you're not going to start trying to advertise that to people who want to buy a million-pound house. It's just pointless. So again, it's focus. Your online presence. Things like TripAdvisor, really important. We like buying from Amazon, don't we? We've got lots of stars and we can trust and things. It tends to convince people to actually buy from those kind of people. And equally, we're put off if people don't have that or if they have negative reviews. So as part of your strategy, what are you doing to get better testimonials, better star ratings on TripAdvisor, depending on business styles and so on? So it's really trying to think of those kind of strategies. Don't forget about Bing. Sorry, colleagues on Google won't like this bit, but they do have the sector of the market. Small sector of the market, about 10% I think in the UK. Strangely, if anyone knows, what's the most common search in Bing?
Google.
Google, the skies like that part of it. Okay. But it's cheap. It's a cheap way of marketing. It's cheaper than Google, so it's something maybe not to totally ignore.
In what proportion do you say cheaper?
I'll deal with that bit in more detail.
Okay,
thanks.
So a few more tips. Use your social networks to help you command your page one positions. Request reviews from your clients, preferably your happy clients. And that's going to help with your ranking factors, which I'm sure you and the Google guys will cover later. How good is your website? And Brad will certainly cover this later. Your website's got to be pretty good. It's got to stand out from the crowd. It's got to work for you. So it's certainly part of your marketing strategy that you want to be thinking about working on. Might be useful again for some of you. Test my site with Google. If any of you have come across that before, you can put in your own URLs, your website into that, and you'll get a report back in a few minutes. And it'll tell you how mobile friendly your sites are, which is quite interesting. So again, a few more tips. Must be mobile friendly. Most searches, most is done from smartphones. It's not really done from PCs or laptops anymore. So how friendly and how good is your website actually on smartphones? Certainly if they're older, they might not be that user-friendly. About leveraging your content. Some of you said you did Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter and all of those kind of things, but it's working out the consistency of your posts. Lots of small businesses I work with, when I start working with them anyway, they say, yeah, I use all of that. And then you look at them, that they've probably only done a post 3 weeks ago and then a LinkedIn a month or 6 weeks ago. There's no way to actually build this consistency, build your presence, build your brand. So really having a really clear strategy of how many posts you're doing, how regularly you're doing it, that consistency is really, really important to you guys. Brad's going to cover later things like pay-per-click and various other options of advertising on your website, which is really, really important. A lot of the stuff that we do on our advertising as well tends to be via lead pages. Do you all use lead pages in some format? Mm-hmm. No? Yes? Yes. Do you? Okay.
Lead pages,
yeah. That's a lead page, which is when you advertise potentially something maybe on your social media or on your website, it then leads you into another page, and that page maybe tells about an event like this one does. So having a look at various options, I think there's a couple, there's lead pages and there's another one, I can't remember the name of it. Lead pages is the most common one, but there's a couple there. Insta page was the other one, I remember. But again, it's really trying to find a way of, if you're doing this stuff, how are you going to test and measure the results? And a lot of people do posts, but then there's no call to action on it. So yeah, great post, and so what? So what happens next? Because you haven't asked them either to phone you, to contact you, to email you, to do something with this post you've done. So it's really trying to help your potential customer come back to you as quickly as possible. So what you're really trying to do is creating a lead funnel. So you're doing loads of stuff to get more leads. You're trying to work through those leads that you've got into which ones of those are potential customers, i.e. prospects, and how many of those prospects can you actually convert into customers. And again, it's really working out your numbers to work out, well, how much activity do you have to actually do to get a customer, which is quite frightening when you start working out the numbers sometimes. So what strategy do you have, and are you sticking to it? Is it really making a difference to develop your business? And is it the right strategy for your business? They're questions for you to think about and to answer yourselves. Do you need some help with that? And do you have that confidence to grow? Do you have that confidence because you're happy with your marketing plan to now start investing some money into it to get where you want to be? So the tips on that one is really track all your numbers. really define what your lead costs are. How much does it cost you to get one person to grow? And how many of those people in the room or in those meetings can you actually convert to customers? And what's the numbers for that? You're really clear where you're trying to get to, so focus on your future and make it happen. So I've given you a little bit of information, and it's then really sort of trying to ask with you, where do you want to go from here? What's the plans for you growing your businesses in the immediate future, in the next 12 months, in the next 3 years? Know what does work, and find out really what's not working that well for you at the moment, and bring in some new ideas. How many of you are actually business owners in the room? As business owners, it's really important that you're the masters of the marketing strategy rather than relying on other people doing it for you. It may well be that you do actually get other more technical people to do some of that work for you, but you've really got to be the masters of it, because ultimately you're responsible for it and you're responsible for the success of your business. So what's the next step? So I've put some forms on your desks. As I said, some of you just want to find out some information today. Some of you have previous experience, you've got established businesses, so I hope you'll enjoy what we're showing you today, and that's absolutely fine. Some of you might be looking for a marketing partner, in which case one of the forms in there is really trying to ask you to arrange a follow-on meeting, and then we can talk in more detail, which would be great. And some of you are just interested in learning, and there's an online marketing course that we promote as well. And if you're interested in that, maybe you could just fill in that form, and again, we could catch up afterwards. Okay, so just to finish off, the main thing is for you, creating your own strategy. And the reason for business help being here is really to try and support small and medium-sized businesses, so we offer all of those services to try and help you. Hopefully what we're doing today will encourage you to get more leads, and really trying to help you work towards getting fast results. So, the options that I mentioned before, very happy to promote one-to-one coaching, talk to you about that. Very happy to talk to you about online marketing. And the online marketing course, that's just one of the slides of one of the pages. But basically, it's a 12-month course with everything online. You get a certain amount of information every month, and it really gets you to be pretty well an expert over the 12-month period, which for some of you could be really helpful. Okay, so hopefully, if I could ask everybody to fill in at least one page of those forms today, that would be great, and I look forward to talking to you again.
Okay, so we're going to hand over to the Google guys now. So, Andrew, are you there? We just need to turn up the volume. Can you get it from there? Andrew, can you see the audience? Can't hear you at all now. Oh, yeah, okay, we can hear you now, Andrew.
Yeah, how's everyone today?
Good, thank you.
Okay. So firstly, it's an apology we didn't get there today. The fog works against us, so we're trying to fly out tonight to Guernsey, but couldn't be with you today. So you've got myself, I'm Andy, and we've got my colleague Will. Can you see Will?
Yes, I can.
So what we'll do is we'll go through a bit of a presentation with you now. Brad's going to be my beautiful assistant for this. Yep. I've just volunteered him to be.
Do you want me to write stuff on the board when you do your interactive bit?
That's the bit. So I can't see it, so you'll have to be my ears, my eyes and my hands today for that,
problem.
Brad. And hopefully we'll answer a few of your questions as we go. So I'm going to share my presentation now, so if you could let me know when you see it.
We can.
Can you see that?
We can, yes.
Okay, fantastic. So, again, thanks very much for having us today. We're really disappointed we couldn't be with you in person. We really like getting out to these events and getting to meet businesses, because what we generally find is that most businesses we come across face very, very similar challenges these days. In such a fast-changing world that we live in now, how do you reach your ideal customer? How do you find them online and how do you engage with them? So that's really the purpose of today. Is hopefully I'm going to cut through a bit of the clutter, clear us up a bit for you, get rid of some of the myths you might have heard about Google advertising, and demonstrate to you how Google Partners and Click Return can work with you to obviously help get you more of those ideal customers. So I think one of the biggest myths that, biggest things that I get asked all the time or hear is that Google is only interested in getting more of our money. Is that something you guys have heard yourselves?
Yes, pretty much.
So I'll clear that up now. Categorically, we absolutely want more of your money. But we want it to work for you. We want you to spend more with us, of course we do, but we want you to get the best return that you can for your money. And that's what my job is. My job and Will's job is to make sure that your advertising gets you that best return on your investment, because what we know is the better you get that return on investment, the more money you will put back into Google products. So it's a win-win for everyone. So hopefully we'll show you a few of the new tips and tricks that we've got to do that for you. So, can you guys still see me on the screen as well as the presentation, or is it just the presentation?
You're in a little window at the bottom of the presentation.
Okay, so this bit might not work, but we'll give it a go. See how it works.
Yep.
So, everyone got one of these with them today. Smartphone.
Yeah.
I bet you there's a few of us who probably have a couple of them. One personal, one for work, quite potentially. Absolutely changed our lives, and I think everyone would agree with that. So I just want to try something that's a little bit different. Might not work because I'm not there with you. But can I ask you all to actually take your smartphones out for a second? And once you've got them out, if you could actually unlock them. Yeah. And then I want that you to pass them to the person on your left. Hopefully there's no embarrassing photos or videos come up at this point, like last week, but hopefully we won't have that repeat. How do you feel at the moment? If you're like me, when I don't have my phone, so when Will nicks it off my desk, I feel exposed. It's like my right arm's missing, because these devices, while they're great, they fundamentally changed our lives. I mean, we bank on them. we book holidays on them, we interact with people around the world on them. They control and rule our lives. And when we don't have access to them, we feel exposed, we really do. So I don't want anyone to lose their phones permanently, so if you can pass them back, I know you might be passing back a better phone than you have, but we're not going to nick anyone's phones here today. And they're great, but at the same time, with how these devices have changed our lives, it's getting very, very difficult to understand how to reach people on them, because it's made our user journey go from being what was a very linear process for the consumer finding the business or the service that they wanted to being a complex mess. But some good things have come out of it as well. So go back a few years, what we found with smartphones were people started looking on them. So they might start researching a holiday as an example on them. But they wanted then to go and have the safety of like booking it on a laptop, something a bit more physical, to give them that comfort level. That's changed. We've actually seen about a 30% increase now in conversions coming straight from smartphones, which is good. But the same one has negative impact as well, which is we're finding people staying on websites 20% shorter than they ever used to. People are more and more impatient, and I'm sure some of you will have experienced it yourselves as well. You go onto a website, you think it's got the product that you want, and it's a bit slow in loading. And what do most people do at that point? They head back and they go onto the next site to get it quicker. You've probably all done that yourselves at some point. But in this ever-changing world, we have this huge level of complexity, but if you know how to read the information right, it does give you a bigger opportunity of how to reach people. So, I can't actually see you guys at the moment, so Brad, you might have to help me out a little bit on this
okay.
one. But can I have a show of hands? Who's been running their business for sort of 10, 15 years? Do we have a few people, Brad?
Two hands.
Sorry?
Two hands we've got, shall
we? Two hands, perfect, thank you. I'm going to ask you two. So go back then. How were you advertising your businesses back then? How were you marketing?
So can we ask one of you two that had your hands up? How were you advertising your business 15 years ago? A
lot of LinkedIn.
Sorry?
A lot of LinkedIn.
Okay.
Yeah. And events.
Yep. And how were you marketing your business back then?
Physical networking.
A lot of physical networking.
Face-to-face.
A lot of face-to-face. A lot of face-to-face meeting people. Did you hear that, Andrew?
Yeah, perfect.
Yep.
Fantastic. Great. And obviously, there's still methods that are valid today. But when you looked at how marketing in general happened, so 15 years ago or so, you had people advertise on TVs if you had particularly big budgets. You could afford to do that, or potentially radio. But in the main, most people found, or most businesses were doing things like flyers, newspaper adverts, maybe billboards, and yellow pages very much so when it used to be the size of a brick when it came through your front door. And it was really good. If you look at yellow pages as an example, if you wanted a plumber, a double glazing, a restaurant, an accountant, you pick up the book, you go to that section, you find who you wanted, you give them a call. But now when you're looking for a business, what's the first thing you do yourselves?
Google it.
If you like, you take your phone out and you Google it, don't you?
Everybody answered Google it then, Andrew, if you didn't catch that.
Oh, fantastic. No, I'm supposing my sound's not very good at this end, so. Yeah, and it's absolutely true. You get your phone out, you Google it, it works really well. And the internet gives you a phenomenal way now of ensuring that you reach the right people out there. But you need to ensure that you reach those right people in the right time, in the right way, and with the right message. And hopefully we're going to show you how to do a bit of that just now. So, at Google, we like to do lots of surveys. And a way for us to find out how the market's prepared for things. And when we're talking about this complex mess that people are going through, we call it internally micro moments. So those tiny moments when people are online and they're doing different things and how we interact with them. So we did a survey about 18 months ago of businesses to try and figure out how many businesses out there with the marketing methods were ready to interpret and reach out to businesses, reach out to consumers or other businesses that are B2B in these moments. So do you have a guess at the percentage of businesses that are ready to identify and deliver on these moments?
12, 20.
So we've had 12 and 20, Andrew.
Yeah, that would be a reasonable amount. 2%. 2%. Now it was 18 months ago. That number should be up a little bit by now. And I'm hoping by the end of this presentation that number have gone up just a little bit from you guys within this room. And certainly, if we can do it today with you, I'm sure between yourselves and Brad afterwards, we'll be able to do it.
Okay.
So, what I want to do is just spend the next 20 minutes getting a little bit more into the detail, focusing on how here at Google we can help you to reach those right customers in those right moments for them, and hopefully give you a few things you can take back to your businesses and start implementing with your companies to reach people the right way. So, as we've discussed already, we're seeing a fundamental shift in how consumers behave on the online. And mobile has fractured that consumer journey massively. It's gone from, it's fractured that consumer journey into hundreds of real-time intent-driven moments. We call them micro-moments. And it's what you need to do now online is be able to interpret these micro-moments, understand them, and reach out to people in the right time. And what we found, though, is that brand loyalty is actually waning these days. What's becoming more and more important to the individual is loyalty to themselves, they're loyal to their own needs in that particular moment in time. So in those I want to know moments, I want to do, I want to buy moments that people do online all day, every day, they care more about satisfying their own needs above everything else. So this is normally quite an interesting one as well. Those of us that are involved in marketing generally probably do this even more than this. But how many times a day would you say the average person unlocks their phone?
Any thinkers?
5 minutes.
60?
60? 100?
600.
Yes. We've got from 60 to 100 to
600. 150 times a day. If you're my daughter, it's probably about 6,000. But I think that's just Snapchat for her personally. 150 times a day on average, and to be honest, I think that number's probably going to be even higher by now. And it is, if you look at the world that we live in now, people are constantly on the smartphones, whether it's out for a family meal, whatever it is. But with these moments in time, we need to understand when people are online, which moments really matter, which of those moments as marketers we need to engage with the person. So, when somebody's online or on their devices that amount of times a day, how do you as a marketer make sense of every moment that they're online and connected? Are all these moments in time equally important, and do you need to win them all as a business? And if you do need to win them all, how do you go about winning them all? Well, the answer to that is you cannot make sense of every single moment. Even we can't, and we know a fair bit, we like to think. Not all the moments and times when people are connected are equally important, and it's being able to interpret the difference between them. And you categorically do not need to win them all. But there are certain moments when the consumer or the business is open to looking in your product, your service. And these are the moments as marketers you need to be ready for and to engage with. So, generally, at this point, what I would like to do is try and break down what we interpret as micro-moments and some of the data that makes up. So, Brad, do you have a whiteboard or a flip chart or something?
I do, and I have a pen at the ready.
That, fantastic. So, let's use last Black Friday, last November. Did anyone around that sort of time make a reasonably sized purchase? I don't know, a TV, a laptop, something along those sorts of lines?
Any takers? Nobody did shopping. Last Black Friday. No. No. Everything round here is cheap all the time.
No, it's not.
We'll try this out, opening up a bit. Well, see, this works better when I'm there, obviously, because I'm hard to say no to, but we'll try this one again. So, who's made a reasonable-sized purchase recently? Some kind.
Okay.
Online.
Online.
Yes. Yeah. What? Online or offline?
Yes. Yeah. Both.
Yeah. Yeah. What did you buy?
I bought a mattress and I bought a grill pan for my oven.
Fantastic. Mattress. Great. So, can you talk to us about when you bought the mattress, how you went about buying it? What was your first step you did?
I didn't buy it online, so I don't know if that makes a difference.
No.
Okay.
That's fine.
So, I went into a store.
Yeah.
So I knew I wanted to buy it. I happened to be passing a furniture store. I went into the store, chatted to the guy, did a bit of research on the different mattresses, and then bought
the
mattress.
In the store?
In the store. But I had already looked at mattresses online.
Ah, so before you'd gone to the store?
Yes.
Okay. So number two is the store?
Yeah.
Because you'd already gone online, and where did you go to do your research?
Well, I did what everyone does, and I Googled new mattresses.
I just want to point out, I did not pay her to say that.
Did that take you to any results?
I was looking for information at that stage, so I wasn't looking to buy, I was looking to understand the difference between different mattresses.
But was all of that information in your search results, or did you end up arriving at a website?
I can't quite remember. I mean, I think I probably went around and about and through quite a few.
How many websites do you think you ended up at before you, in your doing your research?
Probably 5 or 6.
Okay, so you've gone to 5 or 6 websites, and between websites, how did you get to the next one? Did you go back to Google to get to the next one?
I'm talking typically about how I tend to research. Yeah. I go into something, read, and then it'll either take me somewhere else, or I'll think, okay, I've got enough from that, and I'll go back to Google, to the search results, and then I'll look at the next bit down.
Okay, so we've gone from Google for new mattresses.
Yeah.
Then to a website for info.
Yeah.
Then you've either gone to another website from there.
Yeah.
Or you've gone back to Google.
Yeah.
To do another search.
Yeah, or back to the same website. Search.
And then to another website.
Yeah.
What was the type of information that you were getting from the information?
So I was, at that point, I was looking to understand how is it constructed, what are the pros and cons, all of that sort of stuff.
Is that all of that information coming from the person selling it?
Sometimes from the people selling it, and sometimes from other sort of forums, I suppose,
So inside here we've got information and reviews.
Yeah.
And then you took that information back to the store, and that's when you actually made the purchase.
Yeah, I guess. More or less, yeah.
Fantastic. So, can I ask, from when you first started researching online then to when you went into the store and completed the purchase process, how long a period was that over, roughly?
Probably about 6 months.
Okay, great. So, I'm going to put Brad on the spot here. Brad's going to start breaking down some of those moments. We'll see how well Brad knows this for you.
Okay.
Obviously, he's got the information there, but basically, when we talk about micro-moments, it's those moments of time when you're online, when you're starting to engage in a process. At Google, what we can do is interpret people's online behaviour, what they're searching for, the type of information they're browsing, and use that to then target them in a slightly different way. So, if I've got it right from my account at this end, Brad, I think it's about 8 different sources of information, is that right?
Yeah. So you've gone to websites and reviews and to Google, which has led to all of those. The one question I have got, the store that you ended up
buying it from, was that one of the ones that you found on Google prior, or were you just...
No, that was totally opportunistic.
Okay, there you go. That's broken the whole system, Andrew. We might as well all pack up and go.
That's probably a
feature.
That's fine. But that happened. And unfortunately, as Mark mentioned, you cannot win them all. But if some of the websites you've been to, which held the information about the mattresses, if the people who sold those mattresses had been ready to interpret your journey online, they might be able to have got you over as a customer, be it off, online or offline, if they interpreted you the right way.
Correct.
And the way we do that is by looking at your behaviour online. So, yes, obviously, one of the key things you've done is you've gone online, you've searched for a new mattress, particular type, microcoil, whatever it might be, that's fine. That tells us as Google, obviously, that you're in the market for that particular product, which then we can get... We can get businesses to engage with you based on that search behaviour. But what they can also do then is obviously once you've been onto a website, if they're clever, they'll be trying to win you back to the website. And did you actually find that any of them did any remarketing to you to try and bring them back?
I can't remember. Probably.
No. Did all of a sudden mattresses follow you everywhere? Yeah. Yeah, they did follow, I think. If I was involved, they would have followed.
Okay. And they would, and they should have, because they should have been going, here's somebody who's come to us, they're in the market for a mattress, we know that because of their search behaviour. They're then an in-market customer because they're doing more and more research online, they're visiting different websites. But wait a minute, they've come to my site and now they've worked without buying from me. I want to make sure that you buy from me. I don't want you to go and buy from Dreams or whichever other bed company it might be that's doing the mattress. I want you to buy from me, and then they can obviously target you through obviously remarketing. They can do things like dynamic remarketing, which I think, Brad, do you touch on that later on?
Yep.
And different tools about Gmail and different things that we've got. And basically what you need to do is when you've got somebody online doing all this research, is being able to identify them and interrupt their journey path with relevant information so that when they are ready to make that decision, they make that decision by you as opposed to going to anyone else. And your journey there that you've done isn't actually all that uncommon. The average person in 2010 used just over 5 different sources of information before they made a purchase, an informed purchase. In 2011, how many different sources of information do you think people used before buying?
Two or three, we've been told. Audience are giving us.
How many?
2 or 3.
Yep. 10.9.
Sorry, what was that?
Average person was using just about 11 different sources of information before making an informed purchase. And that's 5 years ago. You'll probably find now that number's even higher. Because we're so easily connected to everything these days, because we've got social media and all these other great sources out there, we want to consult every man and their dog about whether it's the right decision for us. So in that cluttered world that we live in, when people are looking at all these different places for information, we need to be able to identify how to reach them in those moments to bring them back. And this is what we're going to do. So these micro-moments that we talk about are very much battlegrounds for businesses these days. Yes, you've got your standard search where there's people, I want a specific product or service. It's these other moments where after they've made that initial decision, we need to make sure that we're winning them to bring them back. And basically, you need to work out if your business is ready to win them in these moments. So there are a few different things we can do. So what we can do at Google is help you find your best audience. So whether that's engaging with repeat customers or reaching out to new ones and win them in the moments that matter to your customer. And the key to doing that is to use a large amount of data that more than likely as a business, you already have. You're probably sitting on it already. Some of you may or may not be using it to its full advantage. And merging it with the great information that we have at Google about people's contextual intent at that moment in time. I mean, you merge them together, it gives you that best opportunity to win these micro moments. So we'll talk about a bit more in a moment about how we define people. So who a person is and what their intent is and what the context is. But if you look at it on this cycle here, what we want to do is take information like your email lists, your CRM data, who's visited your website or your apps in the past. You take that information and you merge it together with what that person's doing at that moment in time, what type of device they're on, where they're physically located, and then their intent signals as well. So are they in the market at that moment in time? And when you put all of that information together, it gives you the maximum opportunity you have to win them. So let's start by having a look at the people that you already know. So customers out there that already know about your business. So first source of information you have on that is, a lot of you probably use CRMs of some description. Would that be fair?
Yeah.
Right. So you've got first party data there. Not only existing customers, probably for a lot of you, you've got current, past, and prospective customers that didn't convert at the time. Secondly, you'll probably have a huge list of information out there for prospects right at the end of your fingertips in the terms of people that have come to your website in the past or your other web assets, your apps, etc. They might have just been on your homepage or a specific product, but you've then not become a customer at the end of it. And being able to interpret that data as well to reach back out to them is incredibly powerful. So how do we do it? Well, immediately, also you can start by creating a highly targeted marketing campaign, thinking about the people out there, so the prospects that already know you. And you do that, first of all, by building that list of data of people we've got information about. Okay? What we can then do is add to that information. So these customers out there, they already know my business. And actually, at this moment in time, they are searching for a product or a service similar to what I already do. And we take those real-time behaviors, those interest signals that we've got, and we add them together. Because what we know is bringing somebody back to you that already knows you, they're far more likely to convert from you. But the odds are they're searching like everyone else plus other competition. But what we need to do on top of that is add to it the location that they're in, because just because they've been a previous customer of yours and just because they're looking for that product or service might not mean that they're right for you at that moment in time, because it might be that your product is limited to that one physical location and they're no longer within there. So bearing that in mind is really important as well. Device can play a part in what they're doing. And then what we also do with the context is look at what they're doing online. So how are they searching? Are they on YouTube? Are they checking Gmail? And then we add to that the other information that we have about what they want to do at that moment in time. Is it they're looking to buy it? Are they wanting reminded about stuff? We add all of this together. And by doing that, it gives you that best opportunity. And we can do it through a couple of different ways. But by taking all this information together, it gives us the option to retarget people. So most people know about remarketing or retargeting. So if somebody visits your website and then you start showing them the same ads for the same products that they might be looking at. Amazon does it all the time. If you ever shopped on Amazon and looked at the night and put in your basket and not bought it, you get followed by it forevermore. And if you're only going to take one thing away from today is get a good tag management system in place on your website so you can engage with those people who haven't converted yet. And that's something that's been around for a while, but using your CRM data is a bit newer. It's only been released about 10 months now, Will. And it's something called Customer Match, and it works a bit like this. So with Customer Match, we can take the email address as an identifier for your customer. You segment your customer data into current, past, previous customers type of information because you want to target them in a different way. So you'd want to show an existing customer a very different advert to somebody who's maybe not used you for a couple of years. You upload all that information into AdWords. It's fully secure. It doesn't go anywhere else. It belongs to you. And basically, we can then track that user online to make sure that we're reaching out to them in the right times for them based on this other information. Which, if you can imagine, if somebody's online and they're looking for a particular product and they've not used you for a while, but when they look for that product, yours is the first ad that they see, they're far more likely to come back to somebody they already know, with everything else being equal, about price and quality of service. But how it works, as I said, you segment your customer data, you break it down into the desired action, so i.e. reactivating lapsed customers. You stick it into AdWords, we then translate that into what we call an audience list, and it's made available for targeting. We can target people across search, Gmail, YouTube, lots of different ways we can to reach people out there. And then you do a custom creative for them as well, say a special offer, or incentive, something to engage with them to bring them back. And it works like this. So, your customer match with that email list you've uploaded into AdWords, we can use that to target people while they're searching, while they're in their Gmail, and while they're watching YouTube videos. We can, because we know that they're an existing customers for you, we can land a tailored message about your business to them. And then remarketing works slightly differently, but remarketing lists sit on top, and we can use them across search and display remarketing on web and in apps as well. And set up right, it works very, very well indeed, because 95% of people do not buy on the first visit to somebody's website. But what we do know is returning visitors, so from your CRM data as an example, or just through general remarketing, not only are they 58% more likely to click on an advert of somebody they already know, they're 42% more likely to convert. And they're 28% cheaper to win them back than it is to find a new customer. Which obviously gives you a better return on your investment, which is what we want to do for you. But for most of us out there, if you look at the two different groups of customers, people we know and people we don't know, unfortunately, the people we don't know is probably going to be the bigger pool of customers, the bigger prospect pool out there. And it's great to position yourself in a way where you're reaching out to previous customers to try and bring them back. But how do you keep topping up that pool? How do you keep adding to that pool of people you already know to make sure you're reaching as many of the right people in the right time? Well, firstly, how do you identify people you don't know? For us, it's a little bit simpler. It's basically anybody that is not already in your CRM and has not visited your website or your app in the past. Literally, they've never come across you before. Again, at Google, we can interpret their intent, so what are they searching for, what are their behaviour, what are the type of websites they're currently on. That can tell us that they might be in the market for a particular product or service by the websites that they're visiting, not just what they're searching for at that time. Again, we want to add to that the contextual information behind how are they doing that, what's the mindset behind what they're doing in that moment in time. And again, thinking about that immediate need, what is it they're actually looking for at that specific time? And again, what we can also do with that is create a similar audience list. And this is something which is quite clever. If you can imagine your perfect customer out there, your perfect client. Most businesses find that their ideal clients all fall within very, very similar pattern behaviours. They generally falls into certain demographic data, they generally have certain behaviours out with of their specific product that they're interested in. We can actually create a similar audience list by looking at your current customers, using the information we know about them to target people specifically that act similar to them online. And it's a really good way of reaching more of those exact customers as well. In addition to that, we can drive prospects to you as well by their intent. So if you're a university, as this example set up here for, we can look at people that are potentially looking at business education or foreign language study and target them with a specific course as well, even though they might not be searching for it at that time. and similar audiences work very, very well to cast the net. The other things we can do is when we're reaching out to people out there is we've got some really clever tools on Gmail. Are you going to touch on Gmail for us?
Yeah.
Brad?
Yeah, I will.
Yeah. Yeah, awesome. So Gmail's one of the newer tools for advertising, but very, very powerful when used the right way. So there are some moments in time when it's not the right time for you to reach out to people based on what they're doing now, at that moment in time or not. But there are times when it is right, and it's in those right moments in time that we can help to identify them for you and to reach them with Google's intent and our contextual data, along with adding in the data that you know about your perfect customers as well. That's about it from me today. I just want to leave you a couple of key takeaways which can be looked at further, obviously in discussions with Brad and then what Will and I can do in the background for them. But the key pieces of information I would say for you to take away from today are to hone your audience. So make sure that you're getting as much information as you can about the people out there who are searching for your products and are visiting your assets. Understand your audience. Understand that customer journey that they take for your business. How people are researching your particular vertical. Make sure you re-engage with prospects you already know. It's one that as marketers we sometimes take for granted that just because somebody's used us before, that they're going to continue to use us in the future. Make sure we intelligently target the prospects that you don't already know. It's about being accurate in your targeting to make sure that we reach out to the right people and drive your conversions through winning more of those micro moments that matter. It really is about interpreting the data with your agency the right way to being able to be able to win those moments in time. And that's it from me, unless anybody's got any questions, which I think will be taken after Brad's section, is that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I think it would probably better to take questions at the end, so if you'll be online as well, then we'll take questions at the end. You and Will can answer them then, if that's okay. Thank you very much, Andrew.
Yeah, perfect, thank you.
So I'm going to get my presentation up now, hang on a second. Bear with me, folks. Technology. This was supposed to be all on one laptop, which is why it's a little bit confusing. Bear with me. So I just want to kind of go through, if we can get that on screen. I need to share, don't I? This is where airports have complicated the matter. That one there. Start sharing. So I just want to go a little bit about me. I'm Click Return as a company. My company's in London, but I partner with Business Coaches, which is where Business Help and Alan Chapman, we work together to help businesses. So Alan's based in Guernsey and works with customers in Guernsey and Jersey. He will have meetings directly with customers and I will work through the marketing plans and the marketing strategies with Alan and the customers directly. Just to kind of give you an understanding of how I work with action coaches specifically, because I work with more than just one action coaches. I've been being trained by Action Coach since I formed this company 5 years ago. We were like a phoenix from the flames. I had been doing exactly what I'm doing now in a different company with a different business partner, but that business partner didn't have the ethics that I liked. So what Action Coach helped me do when I first came across Action Coach was it helped me create an exit plan for my company. I then implemented that exit plan over the 3 month period from actually first meeting Action Coach. And since I've been working with Action Coach, they've helped me grow my company month on month. There are now 6 of us full-time staff over in London, and we are bringing on strategic partners all the time who are giving us business. So instead of us, you know, us running these seminars, us working with other marketing companies and us working with Google, we're growing at a rate that I didn't think possible, and Action Coach is helping us cope with that growth and that business development ourselves. So what we do is we are looking at creating wealth online for businesses. That is our main focus, right? And we're about making websites that are actually a money-making asset. Right? Lots of websites that we go and see, they're just websites. People buy a website, they think that by having a website, all of a sudden, they're going to be profitable and they're going to be making money. But that's not the case. You have to promote it, you have to make sure that the systems work, and you make sure that it's actually people are coming through the door and making a purchase. If you want to grow your business so that you can sell it in the future, you need to make sure that that business is running online without you having to run it, and it will help be an asset. So if you want to get to your company to a stage where it's set with running without you and saleable, then you need to be able to show statistics of how many people hit the website, how many sales that website does, then that becomes an asset to you as a business owner. What we focus on mainly is we are looking at how we can measure what we're doing so that we can increase your profits as quickly as possible and monitor your marketing spend so that we can actually reduce any wasted spend as quickly as we can, because not all marketing works. So what we tend to do is we make sure that if it's working, increase it, if it's not, stop it. When we start with a company, we always start with a big thank you. This is one of the most common mistakes that we see with a company. This is traditionally what you see when somebody goes to your website and goes to fill in the contact form to leave more details. That is what happens once they fill in that form. Most of you will have missed what happened because it was kind of subtle. That's all that happened, right? A little bit of text appeared and the URL did not change. That means, and I see that when we're looking at the statistics of lots of companies that have this form originally, the customer doesn't realize that the form's been submitted. So they push the button three or four times and you get the same form coming in three or four times, which actually screws up my statistics to no end. But so what we tend to do is we start with a thank you page like this. This is a great example that we help one of our customers build. So when they hit submit on that form, the first thing that we want to happen is that the URL changes, right? And that means that we can put our tracking code into that new page, and we know every time a sale has happened or an inquiry arrives, we can then measure that and attribute it to where it's come from. We also change the page. So they understand that they've gone to a thank you page, so you thank them. You also set their expectations. If you know that you're going to get back to your customer in 2 hours, tell them. If they know that actually they need to speak to you before 2 hours, make sure that the phone number's there as well so that they can give you a call. Right? But also, and this is where this page excels, you give them other stuff to do. This has got links to the social media channels, so you can go and see what other people are talking about with them. And it's got links to fabulous examples of their work. This thank you page is so good that actually people, 48% of people would fill in the form and leave. But actually, after this page went live, 23%, only 32% of people would leave. The rest would hang around, look at more case studies, look at more examples. But we were so thorough at testing and measuring that this page actually increased their sales conversion rate by 4%. They didn't make any other changes to their processes, but put this thank you page live, and then all of a sudden, more people were buying. They would give out the quote, and more people agreed to the quote, because they'd been and looked at more case studies and more testimonials, so they understood that they had more faith in the company even after they'd filled in the form. So the thank you page is fantastic. The most important part for me is the fact that we changed the URL, because I'm a statistical junkie. I need to know when somebody fills in that form, and this is where we embed the code. That gives us the ability to find out and track how many times the form's been filled in over a period of time. We can actually then segment that data into, okay, from the organic listings, how many times has that been filled in, and from the paid traffic, and we can drill down into an enormous level of data as to what has caused that form to be filled in. We can see what keywords has created it, what landing pages that had the best results, and we can test and measure all sorts of different marketing, and then use that information. What's come out, and this is really an advantage to lots of companies, that we can actually track the phone calls that come through to your company as well. So first of all, if this is a pay-per-click advert on a mobile phone, and instead of clicking and going through to the website, somebody can click and it phones your company straight away. So they don't actually visit your website, they just click to call you straight from the advert. That costs the same as a click going through to the website, but what it does is means that we track it exactly the same way as somebody actually filling in the form. So we know that they've tried to contact you. So that gives us an extra way of tracking what we do. And depending on the market that you're in, between 30 and 70% of people will pick up the phone. And it depends on how prominent the contact form is on your website as well. But if you've got 70% of the people picking up the phone and you're not tracking when that happens, that's 70% of the conversions you're not measuring to test and measure when you're successful or not. So by doing this, we can do that through the advert specifically. What Google also give us is the ability to embed code into the website so that if somebody does click and go to your website, the code will swap out the phone number for a Google phone number. So they will see a different phone number. That person picks up the phone, goes to your website, picks up the phone and calls you. It just gets directed to your normal phone number, so it's tracked exactly the same way as a form being filled in. So if, you know, in companies that I'm dealing with, 10 or 15% are clicking on the advert and phoning. But actually, 30 to 35% are going to the website, reading the information, reading the testimonial, then picking up the phone. And we can also track those as conversions as well, because that gives us an enormous amount of data to test and measure with what you're doing. Once we've got that data, I can't quite see it. So this gives us the conversion data. This tells us how many conversions are coming within AdWords on each individual product that we're marketing. And we actually can then track if we've spent that amount of money on the advertising, and that's the number of conversions, we know for every £50 we spend, we're selling on a product number one. Now, product number one might be a £250 product, in which case, depending on the profitability of that product, depends on whether that's actually worth continuing to do. Now, this customer, that's about £600-£700, the average customer value for this stuff. So spending £50 to get £600-£700 sale, of which his profit's about 30%, he wants to do it more and more and more, as much as possible. But actually, we can see that actually product number seven is only costing us £5 to make a sale. But there's just not the volume of searches there to do it. There's not enough people searching for it. So we can drill down into the data. Once we've got that conversion data, we can drill down into what's working and what isn't and tell you what it's costing you to sell one of those products or get one of those inquiries. So once we've got that, this leads us to the most important thing that, you know, lots of companies aren't doing when I first meet them, and it's testing and measuring what they're doing. If you're not testing it and you're spending thousands on your marketing, how do you know when it's working or not? And having that tracking in place is key. And the first thing we ask is it working? Does it work? We do this both on your website and the pages on your site, but we actually also ask the same question about individual marketing channels. We'll ask it about Google, we'll ask it about Bing, we'll ask it about Facebook advertising. Does it work? And if we find the answer is yes, fantastic. We can actually then try and make it even better, but do more of it. If you're spending £50 getting 700, how many £50 do you want to give me? That's the question. But more important is actually identifying when it's not working. So we ask the question, does it work? If the answer is no, we can either stop it straight away, so we stop wasting that money, or we can rethink it. Is the message wrong? Is the pricing wrong? What are we saying that we could change to try and make it work? And we can then try again and test and measure and ask the question, does it work? If it's yes, carry on. If it's not, stop, change it. We always start with Google. 99.9% of the time I start with Google, simply because it is the quickest place to get to the market and to test and measure. Right? Now, I have lots of customers come to me asking me about search engine optimization, and they come and they say, I want to be at the top of Google for this keyword. But they have no evidence that that is the keyword of that person at the right point of the buying cycle. So where you know, in my past company, where it wasn't with my non-ethical business partner, he would take that money and just we would start working on their SEO. I no longer do that, right? I do provide SEO, but only if you can prove to me that the keyword that you want to appear at the top of Google for is the right one that converts. And the way that we can do that quickly is we can do it on AdWords, because I can take your budget straight away and put you on the top of Google straight away, and we can test and measure and know whether that is the right keyword within months, instead of spending a year's worth of SEO and realize then that it's driven traffic but nobody's buying. So we always start with Google AdWords first. So those of you that don't know Google AdWords, this is Google AdWords. This screenshot was about 16 months old. This was for a steel milling and turning company, the pay-per-click adverts of the three at the top. Right. Prior to that, there were right-hand column ones, but with the advent of mobile and tablets, the right-hand column was just not being seen by the majority of the people searching, so they got rid of the right-hand column completely. But you can see that how much of that takes up. Then you've got organic listings here, and image listings as well.
Can I answer that?
Yeah, go for it.
I purposely, when I'm searching stuff, I always avoid the ads.
It's not uncommon.
Okay.
But if you've got a top position advert, then you can be getting up to 15% of the traffic on the page. Right? So if you're position one and your advert's right and you're going to the right message and the right keyword and everything else, you know, when I start a pay-per-click campaign, I would suggest that we target grabbing 2% of the search market, but I have customers where it's perfect and it's getting up to 15% of the audience. So it's a lot. You're not going to get everybody, so ideally you want the combination of search engine optimization, but actually if you've got a listing here in the organic listings, you're still going to be missing 15% of the audience. You need to be in both, ideally. So this was 16 months ago. This was done last week. And what's changed is that Google has got more extensions, so your advert gets bigger, right? You want your advert to be bigger, because if it's bigger, you've got more chance of someone seeing it and clicking on it, right? But actually, the top little section there is your normal advert, whereas actually all of that other bit are extensions which make your advert bigger. But you can see the actual effect of what that's had on where the organic listings have turned up. They're further down the page. Right? So I've got companies who have, over the last 10 years, spent an enormous amount of money on search engine optimization, and they've got great positions within the organic listings. But the percentage of their conversions have gone down from organic listings because, one, more mobile devices, and two, more of the above the fold is advertising. So you need that balance between advertising and search engine optimization. And if you manage to get to the first position here, and yet we're still converting for every £50, well, if you don't give me that £50, you're still not going to get the conversions up there, because you're not going to grab 100% of the market from that page in any position. The other thing that you can see on this listing, which didn't come up when I did it 16 months ago, is the business listing, the Google local. So that's driven through Google Maps. It's free to have. Every company should have that. If you haven't got it, it's the first thing that you need to do when you leave this place. It's exceptionally localized. Google knows way too much about you. Because this is in your pocket, Google knows where you are the whole time. Right? And when you search for something, Google wants to make sure that you find what you want. And more often than not, you want something local, so it will show you localized results. And guess what? Google knows where you live. And they know that you're walking down the street. So it will show you a restaurant around the corner. Or it will show you a mattress shop, in theory, that is local to you. Now, we can do that in the advertising, but actually your Google business listing, which is free, is essential, and more traffic is going through this. So this is really good to have for your business and make sure that you kind of weave in the keywords that you want to be found for. It's evolved over the years. So some of you companies that have been around for longer, you might already have it, but it was Google Local in the past. Then Google Plus came out when Google kind of had a panic about Facebook becoming so big. Google Plus didn't really take off, but it's still there. But if you go onto Google and search for Google Business Listing, you'll be able to find a login so that you can get and control that. Now, Google AdWords, Google make it very easy to log into Google AdWords, throw in a bunch of keywords, and set it up yourself. This company, which was a metal turning, they did titanium turning and milling company. It's a very specialist service. When I was introduced to them, they were spending £400 a month for 3 years already when I met them. They were very happy because the inquiries were coming in and they were happy with what was going on. Right? Someone had set it up for them, but the keyword that someone had set up was turning company. Right? And what Google was matching, 35% of their spend was spent on wood turning company. They don't do wood. So 35% of their budget over a 3-year period had gone on keywords which would not have led to a sale. So even though they were happy that with the number of inquiries, 35% of their money was wasted. So within 2 hours, I had identified the problem, fixed it, and the same budget going into their monthly account led to 150% in increase in customer inquiries by simply taking out the word would. And that's just because somebody has set it up and nobody knew what they were doing to maintain it on a monthly basis. So it's exceptionally powerful and it can drive a lot of trails, but it needs constant management to make sure that you're testing, measuring, seeing which keywords work, seeing where you're wasting money and stopping it. Geographical targeting. As we've mentioned, Google knows where you live. Google knows that where everybody is. So actually, if you're on your desktop, they know the IP address of where they are, so they will show you adverts relevant to your location. So when you're advertising, you can be exceptionally specific and go, right, I only want customers that fall inside these areas. So if somebody outside the area searches, they will not see your advert, so therefore you will not waste money on them because you don't want to go to them or they will not travel that far to come and see you. So within your paid advertising, you can be exceptionally specific. And I don't know whether the companies here, they are specifically just Jersey companies or they're UK-wide or global, because actually we can do the same at a local level, and I do that with plumbers, electricians, carpenters. But I also do it with companies who sell internationally, and we have an individual budget for each country. So they spend in Italy, and I can tell them for how much they spend, do they sell a product in Italy, and we adjust all of their global marketing spend on a country-by-country level. This is new. 90% of all text messages are read in 3 minutes. And that's because, let's face it, we're opening our phones 150 times a day, and actually my inbox on my email on my phone is a nightmare. I don't even look at it, it's horrible. But if somebody texts me, I'll look at it and I'll get back to them. And this is common, and actually the new generation of people coming through, my son will be upstairs in his bedroom, and when he wants to know what's for dinner, he will actually text us, which is ridiculous. But it's just the way things are going. So actually what you can do now is directly from your advert, you can communicate with your customers via text. So they can click on the advert, and instead of phoning you or going to your website, they send you a text message. And actually then if you communicate back to them via text message, they're more likely to read it quicker and interact with you quicker. Now I know that becomes a mind-boggling thing because you all think you're going to be sat there communicating with your customers through your mobile phone. But you can, there are online apps which have desktop platforms so that people can text your company and you can manage it exactly like a normal communications platform. Bulk SMS mainly does text messages only, whereas MessageBird does more platforms, because if you think there are kids out there doing Snapchat, Instagram, all of the other messages, and it's not just SMS. So MessageBird will help you communicate with your customers in more platforms. But if you're just going to do the text message from your advert, then bulk SMS will do that. Google Shopping is really important. Basically, pictures say more. Especially if you have a luxury product where it's not quite the same as somebody else's. Actually standing out from the crowd. If you run a normal text advert, standing out from the crowd is very difficult. And actually, if your market is way above others, then basically you're going to actually struggle, because people will go to that website, realize that your product is way more expensive than they wanted to spend on. So you've bought that customer to come to you, and they're not the right customer. Whereas actually with Google Shopping, you can feed all your products to it, and people can see what it is they're buying and how much it is before they want. So if they're in the luxury market, then they're going to see which are the luxury products straight away. Or if they're in the bargain market, they're going to see which is the cheapest one. They go, actually, that's the cheapest one. I just want a cheap item. They can see that straight away. So this is incredibly powerful at driving sales. Sorry about this, Andrew. Google is...
I told you off last time about this.
Yeah, I know. I'm not taking the slide out. So what we have is that Google, I think they've sacked all of their research and development team, because sorry, Bing have sacked all the research and development team. Sorry, Andrew. Because they don't come up with anything new anymore. What they do is they wait for Google to invent it, and then they just duplicate and copy it. Right? Which actually is perfect, because if I want to advertise on Bing, I don't have to reinvent all my marketing again. I just want to test and measure it on Google, make sure that it's profitable, make sure that the ad copy is right, make sure that the keywords are right, and I'm doing that with 80 to 85% of the market. So I'm testing and measuring quickly, I know what works, and then I can just copy it to Bing and run the whole thing on Bing. Right?
Bing
now,
cheaper?
What's that, sorry?
Is Bing cheaper? Much cheaper than
Bing? Bing is cheaper, but there's just not enough people. So unless you have a company that has an enormous market, then Bing is not going to be big enough to run your company on. But the thing that I have is every time I suggest Bing to a customer, a company, they go, well, why do I bother? Nobody uses Bing. Well, 10 to 14% of the UK search market is using Bing. But because of the reaction that all companies that I speak to is, well, why should I bother? There are actually less advertisers on there. Because there's less advertisers, there's less competition, it costs less. So for the companies, all of the companies that I deal with, once we've nailed Google, I recommend Bing, because it's 14% of the market that they're currently ignoring, right? And it's coming in, depending on what they're doing, between 30 and 60% cheaper per conversion than Google. So it is well worth doing, but it's not big enough to run a company on. It's just, and some of the demographics are different. You know, if you buy a PC, it comes with Bing, and depending on your computer competency, you will choose to switch to Google, or if you do not have computer competency, you probably don't even know what Google is, or you wouldn't know how to change it. So therefore, you know, if you've got an older market, Bing might have a more percentage of your older market because they don't know what they're doing as much. So that's the Google chunk. It's a little slither, but it shouldn't be ignored. This is Gmail advertising. So this is the one that Andrew loves so much, and it's sneaky. We love sneaky. So what you do is you use it to piggyback off of your competitor's marketing, right? So this is promotions that will display inside someone's Gmail account, and you can do it on keywords within their emails. So you can look for the content through the content of their emails and look for keywords within there. And I've had varied success on that. But where it really works well is when you actually, if you know who your competitors are, and your competitors are sending out emails, whether that be email marketing or quotes or just communicating with their clients, you can use their company name and their URL as the keyword, which triggers your promotion to display your advert. So an example is that I helped run a serviced office building in North London. Now, to actually get a click through the door to get somebody to take an office is expensive. It's going to cost us between £2.50 and £4.50 a click. That's a lot of money on a normal pay-per-click advertising, which we're measuring, and it's still working, and it's bringing people through the door. But actually, Regus, who, if you've ever used the Regus office, they're quite a big company, if you've ever used one, they're very good at sending you emails regularly. So what we do is we follow all of Regus's customers and we put our promotion inside their Gmail account, which says 1 month's free rent. But we only do that in a geographical location because people aren't going to travel hundreds of miles to come to our office. So I do it to Regus customers within a 10-mile radius of our location. And that's costing me 16 pence per click instead of £4.50. So it's very targeted. It's very sneaky. We love sneaky. So remarketing. So this is where you capture the customers that got away. So they've gone to your website once, and we can then embed code into, you know, their browser, and we understand who they are. So when they then go to other websites, you follow them around. Right? So this is, you know, branded world. It's just a website I go to which gives me JPEGs and things like that of marketing material. But actually, it's a free service. Everything they do is free. They make their money by displaying adverts. Right? Now, this advert is allegedly a company, well, it's a company that I use who are allegedly AdWords experts. Now, what they should be doing is adding me to the list because I've been to their website. Therefore, they follow me. But what they should also be doing is, because I've logged in, they know that I'm a customer. So why are they following me? I'm a customer. They're wasting money. They're supposed to be AdWords experts. They're doing it wrong. Whereas this is a customer of mine. I've been to his website. So his adverts are following me. Right? And it's an exceptionally targeted way of... People rarely convert on the first visit to a website. So you want to follow them around. And you can choose how often this displays and how long for. So you could say, okay, show me 2 or 3 times a day to that person. And follow them for 90 days. You can follow them up to 3 months. Or you can follow them for a couple of weeks. It depends how long your buying cycle is. I mean, in this example, 6 months before you actually purchase this mattress from the first search. So
do you reckon you could use Gmail to get your use your competitors' emails, etc.
Yep.
And then when they come to your site, you can just...
You can then follow them.
Follow them?
Yes.
Well, obviously you can.
Yes. Yes.
That's good.
Yeah, it's fine. And cost per conversion-wise, I mean, the CCTV company, for a new CCTV customer, it's costing about £75. But actually, the people that got away, it's costing them about £35 to capture the one that got away. So actually, it's worth doing because it's cheaper than buying a new one every reasonable time. And you can also put dynamic adverts in. This is another generic advert for one of my customers. If anybody hits any page of that website, the services that they provide don't vary enough for us to distinguish between anything they do. So we have a generic advert which follows people that hit the site. But actually, the one at the top is, my son's used my computer looking for what he would like for his birthday, right? And I can't get rid of the damn...
He knows that advert's going to fall. Yeah.
I've not invited him to one of these sessions yet. But that is that's not just a generic advert. That's the specific computer that he wants. Right? So I know that he wants a £950 computer.
He knows that you know.
He's dreaming. That's exceptionally targeted and really good at converting people, especially if you follow them with that specific pair of shoes or that specific jumper that they've looked at. It's really powerful at converting.
It's a bit annoying though as well.
You can set how often it appears and how long you follow people. So they have control over those settings. Yeah. And actually, if I choose to make it appear loads, then it can be appear annoying.
Yeah.
But it depends how long your buying cycle is. I mean, the first
it's
time...
It's just to get your brand out.
Yeah.
It just seems like it's a small brand, you know, just get that into their head.
Well, this delivers over the display network, right? So these are websites. So The Guardian, they're not getting money out of me to go and look at their stuff. I'm looking at their website. They are making money from running the adverts, right? Now, as a company helping people with their marketing, there are two ways to do the display network. This is a really targeted way because you're following people and it goes over the display network. Now, the other way to do it is you just go, well, actually, show me on any website that's relevant to my industry, right? Now, in the past, I have found that is an exceptionally successful way of burning my customers' money and giving them no return on investment, right? But with what Andrew has talked about earlier, in the fact that you can upload a list of 1,000 of my customers, and Google knows who they are, they know what they do, they know what they look at, then Google will go, well, we've got an incredible amount of information about a profile of what 1,000 of your customers look like. So he can go, right, Google will now go, well, show me another 30,000 people that have got exactly the same profile and interest as my 1,000 customers. And you can do that over the display network, which means that then makes the display network worth doing.
Couple of questions. What do you mean by the display network?
So the display network are blogs, forums, anything that provides a free service. So the way that this Guardian website is generating money is that it's signed up to Google AdSense and it is displaying adverts.
My second question is,
yep.
If you don't have a CRM, mm-hmm. Can you also, so you're ultimately trying to write a list of customers to
the CSV of email addresses is all I need.
Can you also provide that in the form of Facebook likes? So people that have liked you.
Yes. Thank you, Spencer.
But you can't put Facebook likes into Google.
No.
Right? But Facebook have their own version of remarketing, which has probably stalked you in a different place. And the fact that's called Google Facebook Pixel. So you embed a bit of code into your website. Facebook can then follow the people. So this bit is you actually follow the people that have actually been to your website. So like you follow them across the Google Display Network, you can put sponsored posts on Facebook. It's exceptionally powerful. Same as Google remarketing, it's exceptionally powerful. But what Facebook also do is they do this pixel remarketing, but they will also create a lookalike audience. So let's say you've got 1,000 customers who have been to your website. Google will also look at the profiles of those 1,000 customers and create you a lookalike audience. So you can either follow the people, or you can just market to a lookalike audience of people that have the same profile as the people that have been to your site. The slight difference, and this is where Google and Facebook differ, is that Google make operating systems and Google know where you are all the time. Facebook only knows where you are from when you've actually last updated your location or checked in somewhere. So actually, Facebook will probably understand me being in Barnet, because that's where my profile says I am. Facebook doesn't understand that I'm here. And that's slightly different. So
Facebook cannot do that?
Hmm?
Facebook cannot create a duplicate audience?
Yes, it can.
Okay.
It can, yeah. But it's just not as good at geographically understanding where your audience is. Because it doesn't track their movements. It goes on where they checked in or...
It understands where they live there.
Yeah. Where their profile says they are. So, testimonials and reviews, these are increasingly important. Most people that find your company online don't know whether you're good. They have to trust, you know, in the old days, you know, you'd ask someone, they'd recommend a plumber, you'd go and use the plumber. Now they find that person online and they have to look at the testimonials and reviews to find out, am I going to buy from this company? Is this product good? So this is increasingly important in the online space. There are online platforms that help you do that. Reviews, Trustpilot's one of them. Trustpilot's really expensive. Reviews is more reasonable and does pretty much the same things. And if you get enough positive reviews, this is the important part, is that you can get the 5-star rating to appear on your paid advert. And if you, I should have put this slide in the right place. I'm going to flip back to a search engine result, and I'll come back to it. Because if you look at this result, there's no yellow on that page anywhere. So actually, if you manage to get enough reviews to get your star rating appear here, even though you wouldn't be at the top, you might be coming in fourth, you would murder it. You'd be paying less per click, but getting more of the traffic, just because a little bit of yellow would be grabbing people's eye, and your click-through rate would go through the roof. So reviews are increasingly important.
Can you get your logo to appear on there?
I'll get back to my point. There were we. So reviews are increasingly important. Testimonials are, with lots of companies that I deal with, they don't have vast amounts of customers. So the best way to do that is first work on your testimonials page. Right? So what we do is we tend to go into a customer's and they'll go, oh yeah, I've got some testimonials knocking around in a drawer somewhere. And they'll come and get them out, and they'll have received testimonials in the course of their business, but nobody knows about them because they're just in a drawer in the company, the director's desk. So what we do is we will scan them in, we then type it up, we put in a pull quote because we don't actually expect anybody to read it all, but actually we then steal the person's picture and logo off of LinkedIn. Nobody's complained about that yet. We can take it off if they do complain, but what it does is it means that, you know, most testimonial pages we see when we first meet a company is just a line of text. Oh, aren't you brilliant, Bob Essex? Whereas this makes this believable.
there is no doubt that that is a real testimonial, because you've got handwriting, I've got a company logo, I've got pictures.
Would you write, copy it from word to word?
Yes.
Can't bonk it.
Yep.
Sorry, how do you get the stars to show? Which site enables them to show on?
Within the Google AdWords?
Yeah, within Google AdWords.
The best way to do, you can get that from your Google business listing.
Okay.
But getting enough people to your Google business listing and leaving reviews is never, I've never seen it happen. You use an external source of reviews, mm-hmm. which is the software, or Trustpilot. Trustpilot's very expensive, but it's the market leader. Reviews is the one we tend to recommend with customers.
Well, it's reviews.com. So.
Yeah, reviews.co.uk.
Can I just ask about a testimonial? You're saying that, isn't that just an SEO trick as opposed to...
No, because this is about conversion rate on the website. If somebody arrives at the website...
Oh, right, so conversion on the site.
Yeah, so if somebody arrives at your website, they need to be convinced that you're actually good at what you do. And they can read as much as you say about yourself, but actually, we want people to understand that we're good, so we want other people to say about you. So actually, inside here, and while we're on the subject, there's a feedback form. I want more people to come to these seminars so that I can educate people. So I would love, before you leave, I know we want you to fill in one of the other forms, but I would love feedback on what you've felt of what you've learned and what you've done, because I will put those onto my website so that we can kind of help people understand the benefit of coming to one of these seminars.
So let's say if your client bought something on the, say they bought a meal and went to a restaurant, and then you know that they've used that product or they've been
yes.
in, you could send an email to say, could you just give us a quick review
yes.
testimonial?
I mean, getting these testimonials is hard work. The customer that has built this website, and we've been working with him for 3 years now, he's worked his arse off to get these testimonials from his customers, right? But he's a letting agent. When they come to him and say, we would like an increase in the amount of money you give us a month, we'll have that conversation, and when he then agrees, he then goes, oh, actually,
yeah.
give me a testimonial, and he will extract, he'll physically extract it. I think he has bouncers on the door or something.
Yeah.
Right? But never stop. Keep adding testimonials. The more testimonials, the better. Because if you've just got 4 or 5 testimonials, okay. But actually, if I hit a page of a website and I see that each of them is believable and there are 250 of them, I won't see all 250, I might spot check some of them which grab my interest. But the conversion rate of the website goes through the roof. I mean, we did this with a wedding car hire company. And we went and visited them. The website looked good, the pictures were fantastic. And actually, when we... One of the things they said to us was, when someone comes and visits us, they book a car every single time. And on their desk next to them was a photo album which was supposed to be about 2 inches thick, but it was at about 45 degrees. Because, let's face it, at every wedding there's a professional photographer, and the bride's normally happy to be in that situation. So they tend to send a professional photograph with a thank you note. So they've got an enormous amount of testimonials, but none of them were on the website. So we scan them all, and most often there are pictures of happy, smiling brides. So when a bride goes to book a car, what they want to see is a happy, smiling bride. They want to be under the illusion that they're going to have a long and happy life in this marriage. So, and by building that page, the conversion rate on the website, just by doing the testimonial page, the conversion rate went up enormously. They didn't need to spend any more money on marketing, they just kept spending the same amount. But the conversion rate went up by 10 or 15% just by improving the testimonials page. So this is exceptionally important, making people believe that you're good. You can then take it to the next level as well. That company was just giving you examples of what they said, who they were, and pictures of them to make it believable. This company has gone the extra yard. They have, every time they do a job, they take pictures of the job all the way through. So they link every single testimonial to the case study. So if you were ever in doubt about what they do, whether it's believable, there shouldn't be any doubt. There's an example of the work, the customer saying it was good. Why would I not use this company? And it even means that that company can now start putting in higher quotes without reducing their conversion rate, because people believe the quality. Even before they've got to it. this is one of the most common mistakes that we find with companies, and I've spoken to a couple of you here today already. And you post, something interesting happens on your company, and you post it on social media. And yet when I've looked at that website, your company website's probably not been updated for 3 or 4 years. And yet you want to appear on the first page of Google, and yet you're not updating your website. Google likes to see fresh and relevant content. So what you need to do is you need to put your website at the heart of everything that happens. So if anything interesting happens, you put it on your website, not on social media. I'm not saying you don't put it on social media, but why ignore your website? Your website needs it in order to get higher search engine rankings. So what all of your blogs, your testimonials, your pages, your galleries, your forums, everything that you do should go onto your website, right? You then, from your website, can push that stuff out to your social media channels, which means that instead of getting the whole story on social media, someone links back to your website where they can actually see what your offer is, and they can see your call to action, which says, send me money. And also, the other benefit is that those inbound links back from all of your other marketing channels lend a little bit of credibility back to your website. Whereas if your website's got no inbound links, Google, you know, search engine optimization is based on content. Content is king. If you're not adding content, you're not going to get anywhere in search engine optimization. And credibility. And credibility online is basically, if nobody's linking to it and nobody's talking about it, how good can it be, right?
Is it true that Facebook, if you've got a business page, when you put up a post and you, you know, you reach X amount of people, and you're trying to get them to leave Facebook to go to your website, but they don't actually technically reach as many people as you should have?
They're trying to keep people on their site. Not that I'm aware of.
Very few people will see that post though.
Yeah.
It's an organic post. Any tiny percentage of your page likes will see that post.
Yeah.
Unless you pay
for it.
So what we try to do is we try and help customers understand, first of all, the keywords. We test and measure the keywords. We know what keywords convert for you. Then we'll put a plan in place that says, right, the content that you put out, put it on your website and actually include some of those keywords. Don't overkill it, but actually just put them in there and we'll help show you where they should go. And actually we can then help put in place a method of getting that content out to social media. If you've got WordPress websites, then WordPress has some of the functionality built in, or there are plugins available, which will actually do this part for you. They'll push your blog straight out to social media, so you don't need to do it. You just put the stuff on your website and it happens automatically. And for lots of small companies that I deal with, they don't have a budget or the time to be doing social media or keeping it consistent, as Alan said. To put it out on everywhere is really time consuming. Whereas actually we can build the website, you put it on the website and it automatically sticks it on social media. Have you got all that? I'll be asking questions now. There's a lot, isn't there? There's a lot to think about. We can help in several ways. One, we can help you learn it yourself. The platform that Alan has access to help you learn this online, it's really in-depth, right? And there are two ways that you can deal with this. Is one, you can use that learning platform to inform you so that when you're actually having conversations about it, you're not in the dark 100%, right? So that when you're choosing a partner to work with to do your social media, or you're choosing a partner to work with to do your SEO or your pay-per-click advertising, you actually know what they're talking about and you're talking the same language, right? So it's good to learn this information for yourself so that you're talking the right language and you understand and you've taken ownership of this marketing for yourself. The other way is you can actually do it all yourself, but it takes a long time and there's a lot to learn. And there's a lot of fine detail in all of these things. So the online course helps you do that, and it goes through social media channels, LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, does pay-per-click advertising. You know, it's a really full-on course. There's lots in there. But actually, you can dip into any of those courses that you want at any time and do it at your own safe, your own learning pace. So it's a real benefit to companies. I am going to email out all of these presentations.
Oh,
I'd just like to see you busy on your phone. the other thing that we can do, so the other form that you've got is that click return will review your website and your marketing for you. I can do that as a free service. Right? I'll have a look at your website and I will put together a marketing plan at no cost to you. So this is kind of one of our marketing plans that we put together for customers. We will look at the different channels that might be appropriate for your business and we would recommend them. But actually we would then kind of go, the top row there is Google AdWords and a budget for Google AdWords, and that's our maintenance fee. But you can't start all of these things at once. That's too much one for me to manage for you as a customer. And actually it's a nightmare testing and measuring everything that starts all at the same time. So it's better to dip your toe in on Google AdWords to start with. Test and measure, find what works. Then we introduce Bing advertising 2 months down the line once we know that it's working, we've got the right keywords. Then 6-7 months later, we introduce Google remarketing. And we can help produce a plan which meets your budget and your goals. Because if I have a customer comes to me, he's got a £2 million turnover and he wants to get to 5 million and he's got a £500 a month budget, I can tell him that he's not on this plane, he's just in dreamland. We can actually give you a proposal of how much it's going to cost to reach the goals that you want for your company. We work with all size companies. I have companies that work with budgets from £180 a month, so quite small companies, sole traders, gardeners, plumbers, builders, bricklayers, and they're all seeing a return on investment. It's driving their company. Up to companies who are spending £15,000 a month selling furniture and they are doing over £5 million a year in sales.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Is there a price point for products where it's worthwhile? Because if you have a product that's only a low price point, is it not cost effective to do Google Ads?
Yes, it's true. But what we can do as part of the marketing plan that I will give you, this is kind of the culmination of the plan itself. It will include keyword research into the products and keywords that you would want to advertise on. It will give you what Google recommends the cost per click is. And actually, we will be able to say, we need to spend between £20 and £50 to get you a new customer. Now, if your average product sale is £80 and you're making 30% profit, you are then working just to pay Google. But then you've got to understand what is your lifetime value of a customer. Because if you have a longer vision of what your business is, and you know that a customer is going to come back to you every year for the next 5 years, then actually making a profit on day one might not be the thing that you need. I mean, it's critical to cash flow in lots of companies that I deal with. But taking like a dog kennels, as for instance. They were struggling to make conversion, to make it profitable the first time when I first met them. But actually, they weren't considering that once somebody's brought their dog along, that dog lives for quite a long time, and they're going to take 2 or 3 holidays a year. So the email marketing that we started sending out to those people was included vouchers for holidays abroad, because they wanted to go away on holiday more. Right? We can actually give you a proposal of how much it's going to cost you to buy a customer. This comes from my ethical business, from where I changed and started this new business. We don't contract you into anything. We want to make sure that you're profitable. We can test and measure something. If it doesn't work, we don't want you to keep paying Google or keep paying us. There is no point. We want to make sure that you are profitable, so we don't contract you into anything. I work with strategic partners like business coaches, website designers who don't know this stuff. They're brilliant for me because they make websites that are just disastrous. So they're perfect for me because I go the analytics. The website designers are happy as well because the customer is thinking about the website performance and the marketing. A website designer will ordinarily deliver a website and nothing will change on that website for 3 or 4 years. Whereas if I'm involved with a website designer, we are reviewing the performance, giving them feedback, making suggestions of change this, change this, change this, make it better. So therefore the website designer gets more work, the customer gets more happier because there are more inquiries, so I work fabulously with website designers. And marketing agencies who don't understand this stuff. There are lots of them out there that do the more traditional side, where they design stuff, design flyers, direct marketing. So I work really well with marketing agencies that don't do this online stuff. And I work with businesses in all sectors. I've got an inquiry which we're processing at the moment for pessaries. Thank you. Any questions? Andrew, are you still with us? Do you want to unmute?
Yep, we're here.
We're here. Do you want to unmute Will as well?
Yeah, I'm afraid we've got some cross sounds going on.
So, questions?
Yeah, I've been told by a friend very recently that there is something happening where people are being paid to go and click on slides, but they've got no interest in that product.
So this is about, this is a question about click fraud. Will, I think you'll take that one, yeah?
The Russians.
People paying companies to click on people's adverts.
Paid every 20 minutes or whatever.
Yeah, I could take that one. So what it does is the system will automatically look and see if someone is doing that. It'll count them as a click. There's a special column that gets added and you'll see forged click that'll come up there. It comes up there, even if it then 2 weeks later it figures it out that it's been a forged click and you've been charged for it, you'll get credited for that forged click. People that do this then get blacklisted and get kicked off Google completely. So there's loads and loads and loads of ways, tons of articles that have been put out on Google that show you how it does it, how it looks at it, and it's continuously looking at different ways to catch people from doing this. So that's one of the main questions we get asked from people. It is about the fraudulent clicks.
Okay. Any other questions?
The question is around, so I want to understand a bit more about how the intent is modelled with the different customers. So, like, do you have any practical examples of how one would look at a behaviour of a customer set and realise that that customer has intent to buy a mattress at this point in time? Well, I mean, I know that goes into the whole data analytics, but...
Did you get that one, Andrew?
No, I didn't quite catch it.
So basically it's trying to understand specifically how you know when their intent to buy is, as opposed to anything else.
Yeah, so obviously you've got, obviously the first step is this actual Google search that somebody makes, or the Google search partners, search that somebody makes, as in information on the mattress, or I want to buy a mattress, that's everything. Secondly, what we also do is group people to being in market or affinity audiences. So affinity audiences is based on people's historical search patterns of the time that they spend online. So as an example, let's say Brad always looks at football websites, just as an example. I don't know whether he likes football or not, but we'll say that he does. If he's constantly looking at Match of the Day, BBC Sports, Sky Sports, football, that type of thing, we'll put him into an affinity audience for sports enthusiasts, and it will enable us to target him for sports-related products that way. The in-market is based on the search that somebody makes at that time, so I want to buy a mattress, and then the types of websites that they're then going to. So if they visit lots of mattress websites, even sub-sites of, say, Berry as an example, if they're looking at mattresses on there, we group them into that being somebody in market at that time to buy that product. So it's based on their behaviour online at that time.
Okay. Any other
questions? Hopefully that answers it. I've got a little slide that I can put up on that.
Yeah. I'll stop sharing.
Okay. My screen.
Okay, we can see that.
Yeah, now. So, can you see the one with affinity on there?
Yeah.
So, affinity, like you said, is someone that's looking at that kind of thing. So, like you said, football, so someone who checks football scores, they're looking at statistics, we did interviews. Everything it takes, anything, so every time you go to the website, it drops a cookie on there. If it's on the display network, then we know that one, and lots of things like that. Even though looking at everything, you're probably not going to get
put on the in-market list, because they do it all the time, it's not looking at real comparing prices or reviews or things like that. Even if it's looking for the affinity market. Whereas someone who is in market, you know, they do research beforehand. So like we said with the beds earlier, you're looking at different beds, you're looking at different websites that have beds on them, probably went on the reviews, you were looking at then ads on there, and then you were looking at and I'm guessing you went on lots of different websites to look at prices and things like that. So then I would class you in that. So it's complicated how it works. The category is there, when you see the category is there, then it makes a lot more sense as to who it, like how you fall into those kind of categories.
Thank you, Will.
Probably makes it more sense.
Got one more question.
Is there a tool to sort of suggest the AdWords by looking at your website?
To suggest the keywords?
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, and part of the marketing plan that I will do will include that keyword research. And actually, that's one of the first things that I do when I do that with a customer is I just put their website address into the Google AdWords keyword planner. And actually, if you don't see the keywords that you expect to see, you know that the website is awfully search engine optimized because Google doesn't understand what you do. So it's the quickest test that I do to work out whether a website is any good or not, is just chuck a URL into the Google keyword planner. If it's not suggesting what you want, you know your website's a disaster.
Yeah. Also, what we can do on that one is, if you went to Brad, Brad can come to myself and I can put together a full Google proposal as well. And what I can look at is when in your particular industry, when throughout the year the searches are higher, when actually there's more advertisers, when the cost per click's cheaper in the year, when the click-through rate's higher. And I can also have a look at what the rest of your market in that area is doing and suggest keywords and what the average cost per clicks and conversion rates and that we should see based on the area that you work in as well.
Okay. Thank you, Andrew.
Are there any changes in the way that people are going to be using Google AdWords, bearing in mind the starting to increase in speech-based searching?
Is there a change on the searches, in the increase in speech-based searches, Andrew?
Is that going to change the way people...
So that based on voice recognition, is there a change based on people searching for OK Google?
All right, so yeah, so speech search, so be it through obviously any of the Google apps, voice recognition apps or the standalone devices, it still performs a good standard Google search in the background. It's just the software changes the language of it for us to interpret it, so it hasn't actually fundamentally affected anything at all so far.
Anyone else? Right, thank you, gentlemen. I think we'll just hand over to Alan just to wrap up.
Yeah, I think a round of applause for Brad. And fantastic amount of information, so I'm sure everybody's got something for the last couple of hours. Just one final request. If you could just have a quick look at those. If at least you put in a feedback form, that'd be fantastic. And if you want to carry on with any more conversations around supporting businesses on the other forms, that'd be even better. There's one, as I said, on self-paced learning. There's one on the website review and online marketing. And there's one on one-to-one coaching.
The one-to-one coaching, and this is where, you know, as Click Return, where we've been with Action Coach kind of 4.5 years now, it's really helped us as a company grow. So actually having Alan on your side helping point out, you know, what my coach constantly tells me is, isn't that interesting, where he is just pointing out the bloody obvious to me, back at me. And because I'm in the thick of the daily grind of what I'm doing within a business, dealing with seminars, dealing with inquiries, dealing with staff, seeing the obvious when you're inside all of that maelstrom of running a company is a nightmare. So actually Action Coach has helped me grow at a rate I didn't think capable for my company. So I would recommend Action Coach in the process, and you know, it's a no commitment kind of meeting with Alan to see if there is, you know, room there for you to be helped by the Action Coach process.
That'd be great to hear.
Okay.
So thanks everyone for coming.
Thank you.
It's not great then. Yes. I hope we get back to Guernsey. Probably on another fishing boat.